CFTA by indicative date 2017. This decision coincided also with a very important initiative by the African Union member states to boost intra-Africa trade. And boosting intra-Africa trade is one of the objectives underpinning the Continental Integration Initiative, but there are other objectives. The Continental FTA is also expected to contribute to Africa's industrialization endeavors, to broaden its industrial base, to diversify industrial activities, enhance Africa's capacity to produce tradables, goods and services, competitively. Competitiveness is also, therefore, a very important objective that has been articulated for the Continental FTA. This is a tall order. What will be necessary for the CFTA to achieve these very important objectives for African countries? That is the challenge. What will come out as the Continental Free Trade Area, the agreement, the arrangement, will of course depend on the negotiating process, which is due to start in the first quarter of next year. Indeed, the first meeting of the CFTA Trade Negotiating Forum has been postponed from the first week in December to the end of February, and the negotiations are expected at this stage to begin around April next year. But what will be negotiated? At the summit decision in June of this year, where the negotiations were officially launched, we got some indication as to what is envisaged in terms of this negotiation process. There will be two phases of the negotiations. The first phase will cover trade in goods and trade in services along two separate tracks, resulting in two separate agreements. The second phase will focus on investment, competition policy, and intellectual property rights. Now, the scope envisaged here gives me some reason for optimism. It focuses on some of the important disciplines which are important to underpin competitive economic decisions in the 21st century, to participate effectively in the production fragmentation, the global value chains that are really the predominant complex form of firm level and industry organization in this century. But a lot will depend on what African Union members implement. To what extent will the agreement be implemented? And on implementation, Africa's track record, as far as regional integration is concerned, is perhaps less impressive. We are hoping that this can be different. Without further ado, I'd like to invite my colleagues to share with you some of their ideas, their work, on a number of key themes. After which, we will have discussion, and we hope you will engage actively with us in a very good conversation about the Continental FTA process. So I'd like to start with Gerrit Erasmus, who will talk to us about legal and institutional issues for the Continental Free Trade Area. Thanks, Gerrit.
Thanks, Trudy. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Now, what Trudy has referred to, she has given us an introduction, means that sovereign nations will have to come together and create the legal instruments and the institutions to anchor the Continental Free Trade Arrangement. Those instruments will have to be negotiated. It is fine to have political announcements and decisions taken to launch this initiative. The real work will start when those official delegations will come together and start negotiating. Now, this is a very ambitious endeavor, and there is a game plan. And that game plan was adopted in June this year in Johannesburg at a extraordinary AU summit. What I would like to do is to take you through that game plan, to tell you what has been agreed as the negotiating principles and the instrumentalities for how to conduct those negotiations. Let me just mention to you what was stated and adopted in Johannesburg this year when the launch took place. It was decided there should be a comprehensive and mutually beneficial trade agreement among the member states of the AU, and that these negotiations should cover trade in goods, trade in services, and eventually also investment, intellectual property rights, and competition policy, and that it should be conducted in two phases. Now, ladies and gentlemen, if 54 nations, all of them members of the African Union, come together, some of them successful, big, strong economies, and other ones LDCs, it will be quite an undertaking, quite a challenge to bring them all together to finally agree on a text for these agreements, which will be signed and ratified and then enter into force. Only those member states which will ratify will, of course, be parties to this agreement. So I think it's important to emphasize that the CFTA will technically be a standalone arrangement. It will not be part of the African Union machinery. And only those parties which will ratify will be bound. So who they will be, we will see as the process goes on and as they reach through consensus agreement on what the obligations will entail. And then there have been adopted 11 negotiating principles. These are the principles which have to steer the negotiating process. There are about 11 of them, and they have been borrowed from the negotiating principles which were adopted for the tripartite free trade area. Now let me pause a little bit and say something about the tripartite. The tripartite negotiations, well, that decision was taken in 2008, and then they started negotiating in, I think, which was 2011, and before the negotiations started, negotiating principles were adopted and they were subsequently clarified. The tripartite negotiations are still going on. They have not been completed. There is still no agreement on the tariff schedules and the rules of origin and the trade remedies, despite the fact that a document was signed in June this year. That demonstrates one very important factor. Trade in goods, tariff negotiations are extremely difficult and complicated. Our feeling is that, our view is that it would not be the most effective way to start the continental FTA debate, the negotiations, by kicking off with all the energy being focused on tariff negotiations. This 21st century list of demands to be relevant to contemporary needs, the promotion of boosting inter-Africa trade, which is the objective behind this exercise, will force the negotiators, so we argue, to focus on those bottlenecks which prevent intra-African trade. So trade facilitation, infrastructural matters, customs administration, those could be areas where major gains can be made. It would be far more difficult to do the same in the first round with tariff negotiations. Let me just mention to you one or two other of the negotiating principles which will tell us and explain to us how the negotiations are likely to take place. The first one says that these negotiations shall be AU member state / REC or customs union territories driven with support of the African Union. Member state-driven negotiations will mean that the offensive and defensive trade interests, national interests of individual countries will determine their policies, their offers, and how they will negotiate. It will also mean that, as another principle says, that the regional economic communities are the building blocks of the CFTA, and they will continue to exist. Although it is one of the stated objectives to tackle this problem of overlapping membership, it is stated in the launch decision, it is not foreseen that the RECs, the regional economic communities like SADC and COMESA and ECOWAS and those, will disappear. And that brings to the fore another important challenge: how to marry those regional trading blocks with the continental structure. And on that score, let's remember that the tripartite negotiations will now in the new year go into its second phase, where services will be negotiated. But those negotiations on services will take place simultaneously with the continental negotiations on services. And that for us is an indication that the design, the institutional design of the negotiations and the relationship between the tripartite and the continental will also have to be looked at. And that duplication should be avoided. Finally, ladies and gentlemen, there are a number of other important principles. One says the reservation of the acquis. Now, when we started negotiating, when African governments started negotiating the tripartite, we were entertained by the introduction of this novel concept of the acquis. Before those negotiations, we didn't have an acquis. We simply had agreements and obligations. And it was then clarified in the context of the tripartite to mean only tariff concessions. And it resulted in a restriction of the scope of the tripartite in the sense that those free trade areas already existing would not have negotiated further liberalization with each other. We don't know how the acquis will be interpreted for the continental. Hopefully, it will not follow that route, but will be a comprehensive, inclusive concept to look at all the achievements and commitments already existing in the RECs, so that that can serve as a platform to make the CFTA REC Plus. And for that should include the commitments already entered into in, let's say, customs, trade facilitation, transport, those very relevant areas, and of course services to the extent that they exist. Another one, final one, which I want to mention is that there will be variable geometry. It is that principle which allows those states which are able and willing to agree to commitments to do so and move on, and then for others to accede later on. It is politically sensitive, but we think it's possible to give effect to this principle because it's so vital in order to maintain momentum in the way that the overall agreement will be structured. We would like to argue that this arrangement, instead of consisting of separate independent agreements, as the launch may suggest, that it needs an anchor, it needs a founding umbrella agreement, which could be of an institutional nature, and then all these other achievements to be negotiated in an inherently consistent manner and largely simultaneously can be linked to. And that will provide for variable geometry accommodation. Let me just remind you that, for example, in SADC, we have a treaty where all the member states belong, they're parties, but that the various protocols, although they form an integral part of the arrangement, they enter into force through their own rules on entry into force. Only those countries which ratify protocols will be bound by them, and then the protocols will enter, the SADC protocols enter into force when two-thirds of the member states have ratified them. So maybe this is an example of a key with respect to variable geometry that we already have. So to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, the very challenging and interesting phase which now lies ahead of the continental will be when under the auspices of the AU Commission in Addis, this process will start to bring the member states together to launch it, to introduce and explain at that first session in February the rules of procedure, how the structures will work, how decisions will be adopted by way of consensus, how the technical working groups will be composed and speak to each other, and then how the momentum and integrity of that negotiating process, which essentially will be member-driven, will be conducted. Finally, let me also remind you that there is a long-standing debate and a vision in the African Union about continental-wide integration, which is embedded in the Abuja Treaty. The Abuja Treaty of 1991, which aimed at an African economic community. And it is often asked in discussions, but how will the Continental Free Trade Area interact with the Abuja Treaty? We don't know, and there are ways and means of linking it to each other, but as I see it, these are two essentially different activities and processes now unfolding, and if it can be achieved to make the Continental FTA a 20th century type relevant document which will speak to the real needs and the real bottlenecks that prevent intra-Africa trade, it will obviously also mean that our countries and our economies will be better equipped for global integration, not only integration and trade in Africa. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Thanks very much, Gerard. We'll come back with some discussion on some of the issues you've raised. It's now a pleasure to invite Wilhelmien to speak about trade facilitation. Keeping in mind, of course, not very far from here, we have very important processes underway, and of course many African countries are at the moment, if they have not already done so, ratifying the WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement. Thanks, Wilhelmien.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So, like Trudy said, trade facilitation is a very important issue at the moment, and trade facilitation is vital for African countries. Transport interconnectivity in Africa is very poor, and there's also a lack of good governance in terms of efficiency and transparency in processes and administration, like customs operations, customs administration, inspections, and all these add to the direct and indirect cost of doing business in Africa. If we look at, for instance, transit times, TRALIC recently did a GTAP analysis where we looked at what will happen if just the time that it takes for goods to cross the border is just slightly reduced by a small percentage. And what we found is that there's actually massive welfare gains for various countries in Africa. So the international benchmark for goods crossing borders is about 4 days. However, in African countries, the majority of countries have got days that is much more than just 4 days. South Africa, it's example, 18 days. Nigeria, it's 12 days. However, there are some countries which fare fairly well, like Mauritius and Egypt. They're relatively close to the international benchmark. So what we looked at is to see if we just reduce these number of days by 20%, what would the impact be? And there is massive gains for countries like South Africa, Nigeria, Botswana, Zambia, Zimbabwe, Malawi, just by reducing transit days and transit times by 20%, not even down to the international benchmark of 4 days. There can really be benefits. Now, trade facilitation is also a key instrument in the future agendas for regional integration in Africa. Now, this is evident from the amount of trade facilitation programs which have been launched all over the continent. For instance, the Comprehensive Trade and Transport Facilitation Program of the Tripartite Free Trade Arrangement, the Trade Facilitation Program in West Africa, as well as the trade facilitation component in terms of the plan for boosting intra-Africa BIAT in terms of that plan, there's also a trade facilitation cluster. However, it's very uncertain how all these programs are going to interact with one another, and then also in terms of trade facilitation being added in terms of the Continental Free Trade Area as well. Also, it's also uncertain what will be added in terms of trade facilitation in terms of the Continental Free Trade Arrangement. What will be included in there? Now, if the plan for boosting intra-Africa trade is any indication, it seems that we're heading a similar path than the comprehensive transport and trade facilitation program of the tripartite. Now, this program is an overly ambitious and comprehensive trade facilitation program, which includes various issues: one-stop border posts, regional transit management and transit guarantee systems, an online non-tariff barrier mechanism, harmonization of customs operations, customs regulations, customs documentation. However, there has been limited success with this program. There has been no harmonization of customs operations, regulations, anything. Mostly overlapping membership has been cited as being problematic in this area. In terms of one-stop border post, close to 40 border posts were identified and prioritized to be one-stop border posts. Only one is currently functioning due to infrastructure constraints, due to human capacity constraints, due to a requirement for extensive infrastructure investment and development, ITC, to be able to have a one-stop border post. There has been no progress in terms of regional transit guarantee and transit management systems. Also, overlapping membership claiming to be problematic. An online non-tariff barrier mechanism, which is currently only a repository of the barriers which is in place within the tripartite country. It's got no teeth to address these issues. So are we heading the same way? The BIAT also looks at one-stop border posts, harmonization of customs documentation. So it seems we are. But will this actually truly address the concerns of the private sector? It's fine to have infrastructure development, one-stop border posts as long-term plans. But this will take a lot of preparatory work by the member states. They will have to identify those borders which will truly be successful as a one-stop border post. What type of infrastructure development will be needed? Where will that investment come from? What type of human capacity development will be needed? Start doing preparatory work on those issues. Start looking at what is the true issue in terms of harmonization of customs, regulations, operations, documentation. What is the true problems? Are there really such a lot of differences among the countries? Start doing that preparatory work so that in the long term you can have these programs in place as well. But what about the short and the medium term? What will benefit the private sector? What will make it easier, faster, better, cheaper for them to trade within the African continent? Listen to the private sector. They talk about transparency. Make the information available, publicize the information. What is the rules and the regulations? So that they can get a hold of it, so that they know what they need to comply with when they actually want goods to cross the border. Make that available for them. If rules and regulations are going to change, advance publication of those changes so that the goods doesn't come to the border and all of a sudden there's a rules or regulation change in place. Making customs operations efficient, addressing human capacity constraints, making sure ITC is in place, making sure you've got customs operation systems that can actually communicate with one another. What about interagency cooperation within a country? You can also look at cross-border interagency cooperation. Looking at your information or your documentation, your procedures. A lot of customs operations are complex, a lot of documentation. Can a country maybe look at how can they actually simplify that for traders going across border? So looking not just at long-term and big infrastructure projects like one-stop border posts and harmonization, but also how will the private sector be able to benefit in your short and your medium term? Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, Wilhelmine. JB, we now turn to you, and JB's going to share with us some ideas on shaping a trade and services agenda for the Continental Free Trade Area. Thanks, JB.
Thank you, Trudy. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Yes, as Trudy has already said, that the CFTA negotiations will focus on trading in services and trading goods during the first phase of the negotiations. Now, a trade in services agreement is not an end unto itself. It must address the challenges and the difficulties experienced by those conducting trade across borders, on the continent. But it should also go beyond that and improve efficiency. It should improve competition, the quality of services, and the protection of consumers. Now, considering the challenges and the objectives that must be achieved, the member states could consider what would be possible solutions to these problems. Now, this could include, say, for example, the setting of minimum standards. This could include the adoption of best practices that on the development, the implementation, and the review of domestic regulations. It could include mechanisms that would enhance transparency of national laws and regulations that would help small and medium-sized enterprises to identify the trade opportunities on the continent and to make use of it. And it could also include the adoption of rules, for example, that would promote and secure electronic commerce, for example. Now, having considered the possible solutions, member states now need to reduce this into writing and capture it within a legal framework that is binding and is user-friendly. So this brings me back to the mandate provided by the member states and the possible approaches that could be adopted for the negotiation of trading services agreement. Now, whatever approach must be adopted, you need to consider the sequence of the negotiation, the scope of the negotiations, but also the roadmap that was adopted. Member states must start and conclude these negotiations within a short period of time. So they only have 2 years to complete the negotiations, and this must result in something that can be implemented, but also something that has that can deliver economically relevant results. So, what could be a possible approach that could be followed by the member states? For me, I would say the consideration of a typical request-offer approach that was adopted by many of the RECs, but also something that is similar to those adopted by the WTO member states, would not work in this context, because that would deliver a very protracted negotiations that is not cost effective. Remember, the taxpayers of member states will need to pay for these negotiations, and And considering the roadmap that was adopted, member states should rather focus on something else. Now, I would say a possible approach is rather to a voluntary approach that is inclusive, that would allow member states to commit only autonomous liberalization, or the autonomous levels of liberalization currently that applies in the domestic legal frameworks at the moment, to commit only that as a minimum or as a starting point. And this would obviously require member states to do national regulatory audits. The African Union Commission can help them with that. They can maybe, for example, develop possible templates in which these audits can be captured, and that is also comparable across member states. Again, that would be user-friendly for the end users, the business community, to identify the investment climate in countries and the regulatory frameworks in countries. Okay, but then at the sector level, member states can go beyond this and discuss with national, regional, and continental regulatory authorities and competition authorities, and also the business community, some pro-competitive disciplines that on the adoption of national regulations, but also disciplines that would minimize divergence between the national regulations of member states. Of course, provision must be made for member states to maintain certain non-conforming measures or discriminatory measures that would still allow them to pursue their national policy objectives. So member states will obviously be allowed to maintain or to enter certain reservations in these negotiations, but I think this could possibly be a more realistic approach considering the mandate that was provided by the member states. Thank you.
Thanks very much, JB. We now turn to William Wanza, and William's going to share with us some thoughts on dispute resolution. Now, we see this as a very, very important component of a rules-based continental free trade area. William?
Thanks, Trudy, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Following on from Professor Erasmus' discussion on the legal and institutional issues, my point of departure and emphasis is that the utility of the CFTA agreement that will be adopted ultimately lies in the enforcement of the obligations that will be undertaken by member states. And dispute settlement is a fundamental and intrinsic part of such enforcement. And this immediately raises the question of whether there should be a dedicated dispute settlement arrangement with the jurisdiction to actually preside over disputes in the application of the CFTA agreement. So in interrogating this question, I do two things. Firstly, I explore the AU legal architecture, trying to explore for an existing or potential dispute settlement forum for the CFTA. And secondly, I look at the interaction of such a forum with other dispute settlement mechanisms at the continental, at the regional, and at the national levels. So firstly, in exploring the architecture of the AU, first we see that the AU legal framework is quite fragmented. It's a collection of a body of agreements that are guiding, that were adopted at different points in time, and that are guiding different activities of AU law. And also what starts to emerge is a fragmented and a contrasting dispute settlement picture. When I start tracing it chronologically, we can start from 1963 with the OEU Charter, which provided for a commission of mediation, conciliation, and arbitration in the event that member states cannot settle the disputes amicably. In 1991, the Abuja Treaty then provided for a Court of Justice of the African Union. And then at the transition from the OAU to the AU in 2002, the Constitutive Act of the AU provides for a Court of Justice of the African Union, or the African Court of Justice. Specifically, the Constitutive Act provides that the provisions of the Constitutive Act itself actually supersede those of the OAU, of the OAU Charter, and the Abuja Treaty. And so, in effect, this would be the court that would be responsible for the integration process. Interestingly, what we noted that this African Court of Justice has up to date not been established, but in its absence, there have been other judicial bodies that have actually come into existence. So, for example, the African Court on Human and People's Rights came into existence in 2004. But when we look at the operations of that court, it actually demonstrates quite a contrast between the legal instruments themselves in the African Union and the actual practice on the ground. This is especially because in 2008, the African Court of Human and People's Rights was merged with the African Court of Justice to form what would be known as the African Court of Justice and Human Rights. Now, this later court has also not come into existence. But in its absence, the African Court of Human and People's Rights, though it was merged on the basis of the legal text, it actually continues to exercise its judicial functions based on the previous protocol, or the Banjul Protocol of 2004. So this fragmented and contrasting status of dispute mechanisms in the AU would definitely need to be clarified. But what is clear at this point is that there's no specialized forum that exists for trade and economic integration disputes, but yet it would make sense for one to exist. And this is not only because the specialized areas of AU law are best regulated by specialized dispute settlement mechanisms, but I think, as also alluded to by Professor Erasmus, when it comes to the agreement itself, this would only be binding on parties that have actually ratified the agreement and actually accept to be bound by it. And so it makes sense to have a specific dispute settlement mechanism applying to the engagement as they actually implement this this agreement. And I'll turn to the interaction of the of such a forum with other continental, regional, and national mechanisms. At the continental level, such a dispute settlement mechanism would have to interact with other dispute settlement mechanisms within the AU. And this is especially because the areas of AU law are interrelated, so there would need to be some interaction at that level. But there are other pertinent questions that also arise. And firstly, there's how such a mechanism would interact with regional and national laws and institutions. And also, importantly, as Trudy mentioned, whether private individuals would have standing in such a forum. On the first point, what we observe in other parts of AU law, for example, in the African Court of Human and People's Rights, is that that court has ruled that it doesn't have jurisdiction to entertain references that have actually been decided by national courts. Now, this is different from the approach that has been taken by other regional courts on the continent, such as the COMESA Court of Justice and the East African Community Court of Justice. I'll just highlight one recent case in the COMESA Court of Justice, which was between Malawi Mobile and the Malawi government and the Malawi Communications Regulator Authority. It's a recent case. It was just decided upon at the end of November. But the court in that case has actually found that it does have jurisdiction to hear a matter after the national court processes in an individual member state have been exhausted, and that it would also have to consider the national laws and actions of the member state for it to determine whether it's in line with its obligations under the treaty. This follows on from another case that was also decided by the COMESA court in 2013 between Polytor Paints and Mauritius. But crucially, what this case also demonstrated is that natural and legal persons resident in COMESA actually have access to the COMESA Court of Justice to seek redress where they feel that their rights have been infringed. This private party access has also been guaranteed, for example, in the East African community. Such standing, we argue, is important, particularly because of the observed trend where African states seem quite averse to litigating against each other over trade matters. And such provision for direct access by private parties, allowing them to seek redress beyond their national jurisdictions, actually goes a long way in ensuring a stable and a predictable business and trade environment, which would be for the benefit of companies, investors, and consumers themselves, who are the intended beneficiaries of such regional integration arrangements. And so it would be advisable for a dispute settlement mechanism for the CFTA to also adopt such an approach by ensuring, so just in conclusion, by ensuring that that dispute settlement mechanism effectively interacts with other continental mechanisms and also regional and national laws and institutions, and also by ensuring access by private individuals. Such a mechanism would go a long way in ensuring that the CFT operates on the basis of a rules-based system, and would ensure that the benefits that would accrue from such an agreement can actually be well safeguarded. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, William. As you've heard, ladies and gentlemen, we are, from Trulloc's side, trying to promote a more practical approach to shaping the agenda, the design of the agreement, and to looking at issues that address the fundamental challenges that African entrepreneurs, investors, producers, traders, and consumers face. A practical approach to shaping a continental integration agenda. It's extremely cold up here. And so I'm going to ask my colleagues to join me down here to come closer to you so that we can warm up this discussion and get your responses and reactions and engage in some debate. Are you also cold? But if you come closer, perhaps we can warm up the discussion. We were freezing up there. In essence, what you've heard this morning is that if one takes a look at the fundamental challenges that economic agents in Africa, investors, producers, traders, consumers, all of us face on the African continent, they motivate very strongly for a very practical approach to regional integration. And we have a significant opportunity with the CFTA to shape a new agenda. A new agenda in terms of the substantive issues that will be covered in those legal instruments to be negotiated, but also that will inform, for example, the sequencing of the negotiations. The ambition to achieve early harvests has been articulated.
What is an early harvest?
A quick success story. In other words, negotiations where we may be dealing with issues which are less contentious than, for example, tariffs. As soon as we start looking at the import tariff, which still remains perhaps the center piece of the collection of trade policy instruments for many countries, for various reasons, reasons of revenue, reasons of industrial protection, keeping out import competition, this is incredibly sensitive, and we tend to get bogged down, as we've seen in the tripartite FTA negotiations. But if we take a look at, for example, the tripartite FTA negotiations, there are other areas of substantive issues that have proceeded perhaps with greater ease. Shouldn't we be focusing on those in the first instance? So, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to share the microphones with you, your questions, issues, and our panel will interact. Any questions or issues? And I see a number of hands. Brian, you're going to help here. Portfolio Committee on Trade and Industry. Ms. Fubbs, your question.
If I may, I have three. Is that all right? The one that immediately comes to mind, what arose out of William's input, what prevents an AU member state member in the CFTA from pursuing it through the WTO dispute mechanism other than a financial issue. And the other one is the transit issues. I think that was Wilmien for Yun. You spoke about all these increases, but I mean, that was almost in general. If specifically what increases the time, 18 days, 10 days, when it should be closer to 4 days, all right? And the final one I have is the issue of implementation. I'm not sure who mentioned capacity issues. Will we have the capacity in the CFTA to implement? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Morning. Elizabeth Wachivinga Gaswaga, Legal Advisor, Rule of Law with the Commonwealth Secretariat. My portfolio covers use of rule of law to deliver on the development agenda, but on the other hand, also rule of law as a goal for sustainable development. My question will be, what, if any, has been the experience of adoption of model laws, guidelines for the African Union on any of the issues that the policy areas that the African Union covers? And if this has been in place, or if there's a plan to have the model laws, guidelines, what should we look for? What should be the strategies? Because the Commonwealth does so for its member states, and 17 of them are in Africa. So we have a very keen interest in how this develops. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Hannes Schliemann of WTI Advisors. Thank you so much for this session. Very interesting, very stimulating. I think the whole CFTA exercise is incredibly stimulating. Question is this the Africa's answer to TTIP, TPP, RCEP, and all those other big animals around? I have a number of questions. I'll try to squeeze them into just a few. The first one is on the mechanics of implementation. I wonder, APEC has experimented, for example, APEC has experimented very successfully with peer review. And I'm talking about serious peer review, three countries visiting one, helping, assisting, a lot of intelligent transfer of intelligent solutions, and at the same time, a little bit of pressure that is usually welcome because the government needs to face its own constituency at home and needs others to help build reasonable arguments. So that question is, how much of that can we build into CFTA to help with implementation? The second question is, the question of capacity was raised. Obviously, attitude and mindset plays a big role, not only in borders, but also elsewhere. What are we doing on that? I think soft law soft mechanisms might be of high interest here. The third question is on the architecture. Gerhard, I am pleased, like you, that goods and services are to be negotiated at the same time. I don't think parallel tracks is what we need. I think we need one track, because goods and services are no longer two things. They are one thing. We live in the age of servicification, and any compartmentalization is actually wrong. That leads me to my fourth concern, which is services and investment separated. Is that a good idea in the 21st century? I don't think so. So that concerns me very much, and I was wondering whether we can improve on that. I stop here. I have 15 more, but I'll stop here.
Good morning. This is Van Fries from the Embassy of Sweden in Addis. Couple of questions pretty much related as well. Truly say you hope that the implementation will be different this time around, and the question is why what would be different this time around, and if you look into the rate of implementation at the regional level, always implementation of regional agreements, domestication and implementation is quite a challenge, and even at the regional and sub-regional level, partly at the heart of this problem is the tendency of member states to really preserve their sovereignty, essentially the tendency of the reluctance to really surrender their sovereignty to the intergovernmental organizations. And if that has been a challenge at a sub-regional and regional level, wouldn't it even be more problematic when it comes to an African kind of arrangement? So should we is there some level of optimism in that? That's my first question, and second, maybe to Professor Erasmus. You said indeed this whole CFTA agenda is quite ambitious. I might also add a question of, is it even realistic? From a time, for instance, if we look into the time frame of 2017, is it and given the fact that it's going to be a member state-driven process, which in a way may not necessarily build upon what has been negotiated so far at the regional and sub-regional level, is it even possible to really harvest, to even have an early harvest in 2017? And not only a question of realism, is it also a sort of a demand-driven process from the member states? That also relates to the question of a political win, and also as well as given the status quo of regional integration in the different regions, where, for instance, if you look into the 8 regional economic communities duly recognized by the AU, for instance, we have IGAD, which doesn't even have a free trade area. We have the COMESA, where a few member states have not even yet signed the free trade area. And in many of these regions, a deeper level of integration is quite a challenge. So if a deeper level of integration at the regional and sub-regional level is tricky, then can we really say the CFTA is quite demand-driven? And that also links to the issue of trade facilitation and whether the CFTA, even if it's actually agreed at some level, whether it's actually impactful for the private sector and for the continent in general. For instance, to put the question a bit differently, would a fully agreed CFTA be any more impactful than a modestly implemented trade facilitation arrangement, for instance, at a very decent level? As you said, maybe you don't even really need a one-stop border post in every corner of the region. So the question of demand supply.
Thank you very much. I'm going to ask our panel to provide some responses. I do notice that there are quite a few other hands. Some of the concerns that are being articulated are very much part of the debates we're having at TRALAC. Overly ambitious initiatives, we've seen many of them. So a practical, more modest agenda may well start in an incremental approach to address the real challenges of the private parties at the end of the day. And this is really what we're trying to motivate. I would hand over to the panel. I'll start with Harriet Erasmus and literally go down there. Questions for everybody here. Thanks,
Tara. Thank you. Thanks, Trudy. Anas, I agree with you that there is a real danger that the manner in which the launch suggests the negotiation should be conducted can result to fragmentation. And it will be up to the organizers and those that are responsible for the negotiations to understand this very important point. The 21st century, the needs of Africa need integrated negotiations that speak to each other and integrated outcomes. The question now is, how is that obvious point being conveyed to the participants? And that is why we all have to keep writing and publishing and participating, the private sector and legislatures, in making sure that the focus is the right one. I don't think there's more than we can do but to recognize at this point that the design, the plan, is not optimal. There are flaws, there are conceptual difficulties there. Model laws fine by all means, but do you need a continental free trade area just to implement model laws? To what extent will institutions be required? And this is one thing that we haven't yet discussed. Will this continental FTA have its own institutions to do and to address the needs about implementation, capacity, building in member states, following up, preparing and disseminating model laws? I think it will. Whether member states, being concerned about their sovereignty, will allow the creation and the adoption as part of the negotiations of well-empowered institutions, I don't know. Indications are not good. The final point is the one about peer evaluation, and can we have more effective compliance in inducing mechanisms. They're not difficult to design. They're all over the globe. It is not difficult to think of ways and means to write into agreements so that they can be more effectively monitored and implemented. And you can start by giving the private sector some standing in those essential areas where their rights are at stake. We have to admit, however, that our governments in Africa do not litigate against each other on trade issues, full stop. And sometimes they will take away, they will abolish those institutions that have the audacity to rule against the lawfulness of their behavior or the behavior of member states, like happened to the SADC tribunal. So I'm not very optimistic on that score, but William can say more about it. There is an interesting development, however, and that is we see it more and more in domestic courts. There have been a number of very interesting cases in SACU where private companies will litigate before domestic courts about trade issues. Now, they cannot invoke these trade agreements directly as part of the law of the land, and therefore they start tackling regulatory issues, administrative law procedures. Have you applied your mind to the matter of government when you impose these restrictions or the indicated or suggested that you're complying with an international agreement? So the exceptions clauses, the derogations, the rules-based basis for when deviations may be possible, that's part of William's point, must be part and parcel of the design. What we are really arguing for and hoping for is a very ambitious upping of the game towards a rules-based approach to trade. We are not there yet. And we cannot, in all honesty, claim that on the basis of past history that we will see a dramatic increase in that potential. I hope we will. But that point must be made over and over again. And let's see whether we can have these incremental improvements. There are some positive signs in some of the regs.
Okay, the days of transit. The majority in South Africa, there's 18 days for goods to cross the border. Three of those days are specifically in terms of internal projects, of internal programs, in terms of paperwork that needs to be filled in. 11 of those days happens in ports. So it's goods being stuck in ports and port procedures and customs operations, which actually takes 11 days in South Africa. And these delays, I know in Angola it's exactly the same, in Nigeria it's exactly the same. The majority of the delay happens at the ports, at the port of entry, which is inefficient customs operations. And there's also relatively a lack of transparency, as the guys don't actually know what's happening at the port, but they know it takes 11, 12, 13, 14 days for their goods to actually clear. So the majority of those days and problems with transit times is efficient customs operations. In terms of model laws, I can just tell you the experience in terms of SADC. SADC had a model law, customs model law, that they wanted to implement in terms to actually harmonize customs documentation, border operations, all of that. Only 4 countries out of the 15 have actually taken that model law aboard. The other countries are all citing overlapping membership with other regional economic communities as the reason why they can't do it. So in terms of, is there a need for a free trade area, a free trade agreement, or just can't we just look at trade facilitation? The only thing that you must then remember is you're cutting out issues like services, investment, competition. You know, if you're only looking at trade facilitation, you're cutting out vital other areas, which will also be, which is also important in terms of trade within Africa. Trade facilitation is important, yes. Each and every border post doesn't have to be a one-stop border post. Like I say, do preparatory work. Identify key border posts which are really problematic
and where your traders will really benefit if it can be a one-stop border post. But you don't have to have 40 border posts within the tripartite country being a one-stop border post. There's no need for that. Thank you.
Thanks, Trudy. On the question of what would prevent countries from taking cases to the WTO, apart from finance and perhaps going all the way to Geneva to settle matters that can be settled here, ideally, I think nothing can stop countries to litigate at the WTO over a trade issue of another member state. They're all these agreements are WTO compatible, and all the members are also WTO members, well, most of them. Within the regional trade agreements, there are also some of the technical areas actually just bring in the WTO dispensation. So like sanitary and phytosanitary measures, like some of those agreements, they'll just refer to the WTO agreement and say these would be governed by the WTO. So in those instances, you'd see perhaps cases being taken to the WTO. But what's interesting is that the WTO allows for only interstate disputes. So if a company has a problem, it can't directly take a case to the WTO. It would have to be its own government taking that case on its behalf, and this is what happens presently. But then what's also interesting is that in these regional trade agreements, what's been observed is that some of the infringements may not really only relate to infringements by another country. It could actually be a company domesticated or incorporated in a specific country, but then litigating against infringements by its own government. So in that instance, it wouldn't lobby its own government to take the case to the WTO. That's where, after going through the national court process, it then has this regional access. And that's actually what has happened in the Polytor case that I mentioned. It's a company that's incorporated in Mauritius, litigating against the government of Mauritius. And in the Malawi mobile case, it's also a Malawian company litigating against the Malawi government. Thank you.
Just shortly, with regards to the initiatives that have been taken at regional levels, yes, there are many success stories at the regional level where member states have tried to harmonize regulation or even qualifications, but many of these initiatives are not legally binding, first of all, and then you will see unequal level of implementation among member states. Some member states would implement and others would do absolutely nothing. So coming back then to my suggestion of doing national regulatory audits to determine what is the basis from which the CFTA can proceed. The separation of trade and goods and services and competition and investment, it is not ideal. Ideally, they should be negotiated together. But the mandate on the second phase, it provides that member states must then, in the second phase, negotiate competition law, investment, and intellectual property. But then it doesn't say in what format this should be done and how it should be done. So in my view, the member states have provided an incomplete negotiating mandate to the trade negotiators. And I don't know to what extent that the sequence for the negotiations can be reviewed or reconsidered in order to negotiate a comprehensive agreement. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I think just a couple of issues before we take our final round relating to political economy issues that were raised. And Harriet is just reminding us that the indicative date, the 2017, is just that, negotiations tend to take a lot longer than often is anticipated. So although this date is being raised in discussions, it is likely that the negotiations are going to take a lot longer. I think JB's point about the interconnections of the different substantive issues are particularly important to keep in mind. Can the negotiators actually still find the policy space, so to speak, to shape an agenda that creates a truly integrated, internally consistent, robust agreement that builds on these connections between trade and services, investment, competition, regulation, competition policy, and so on. Very, very important. The tripartite free trade area, for those of you perhaps not coming from the Eastern Southern African region, was envisaged as a comprehensive free trade area that would solve, amongst other problems, the overlapping membership. Let's take a few more questions. We are heading into our deadline. I saw Sherry, I saw colleague here, and me.
Hi, I'm Mark Wu from Harvard. Question concerning regulatory harmonization. You spoke a little bit about SPS measures, but I'm curious what possibilities you see, if any, from a political economy standpoint, of any additional regulatory harmonization, particularly on SPS measures. And then the question as to whether we see deviations of port delays for agricultural products, and to what extent some harmonization on this would help to address those types of delays, or whether these are purely real customs related types of trade facilitation as opposed to regulatory inspections and so forth when it comes to agricultural products at port.
Sherry?
Thanks. Sherry Stevenson, ICTSD. Thank you very much to the panel. The CFTA represents a huge opportunity for Africa. It also represents huge challenge. It would be preferable for the AU members as a whole to agree upon, as JB suggested, binding existing liberalization, autonomous liberalization that they have actually achieved at the RECs in many cases, but in the individual level as well. Take this, use this as an early harvest, bind it, and use it as a baseline for moving forward, so that there is at least a baseline at the continental level on which one can work. And then the variable geometry aspect could come not in the universal obligation, but with respect to the time, the implementation, and the time frames agreed for individual members to go forward with additional liberalization.
Harry?
I'm Murabu Odari from Siasa Place, a political hub based in Kenya. We have been having a series of dialogues on the 10th Ministerial Conference with the youth. So I have a question away from the technicalities. Now, it's one question in two parts. How are we ensuring, because I had an issue of policy dialogues, how are we ensuring that we have these dialogues within learning institutions so that the next generation of negotiators, of implementers, and everybody else does understand where we are coming from, so that as you reach to that office and you hear, you see this document, you have a leaning on what actually took it to that place. And secondly, and most importantly, how are we bringing the general citizenry into these discussions? You're talking about states, you're talking about WTO, you're talking about organizations and things, but not people. And two cases come to mind: the xenophobia attacks in South Africa. And then there was an issue in Kenya, between Kenya and Uganda, when the president talked about importation of sugar from Uganda, which had been a process of a long trade negotiation since, I think, 1995. Then it was reached early this year. But the impact in Kenya, the politicization, and the way the citizens looked at it was very different. So how are we bringing the youth and the citizen into these discussions? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I've just got indication that we should be wrapping up the session. I did give a microphone to Nick, and I see a few hands. But Nick, 1 minute, please. Okay.
Thanks, and it's Nick Charalambides from Imani Development, Cape Town. It's funny that we're meeting in Nairobi when we're 50 kilometers away. But lovely to see you, and thanks for this. I think a few observations that lead to questions. If we had to choose between yet one more negotiation and implementing what we already have, I think we all know we would choose implementation. So a question, how can we use the CFTA or can we use the CFTA to improve implementation? That brings up the peer review mechanism. Question, have we done a forensic on the failure of MEPAD? Is what we're doing is how we're thinking, looking at the failures of the past. I think the other question I have is if the ultimate prize is the move eventually towards more rules-based trade, where is the early harvest? In particular, I think that leads to the huge, from my perspective, political economy question, which is South Africa and how we manage it. South Africa has withdrawn from its investment treaties, the trying to get a work permit, the sharing of skills, the movement of people, and this is all being clamped down. How can we bring goods, services, and investment together when one of the countries that has the greatest interest in seeing movement of this within the continent is politically constrained from offering anything? So thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. Some very direct questions to us coming from South Africa. I'm going to take one more question, Elizabeth, and then we'll have a quick wrap up because the next session are about to move in.
Mine is very quick and straight and it's directed to William. Excuse me. You talked about EAC Court of Justice accessing or allowing private citizens and companies direct access. But we have a recently passed law on NTPs in the EAC that does not give that provisions to citizens or even companies. Is there any way a company can invoke the provisions of the EACJ and bypass what is allowed by a specific law to seek redress in trade disputes?
Ready to wrap up now, and I think there were some really interesting comments and contributions. Anyone on the panel, literally 30 seconds to respond.
The question about SPS. Yes, the trade agreements, previous trade, all the RECs in terms of SADC, EAC, all those, they just revert back to the WTO and say that, you know, you need to look at your WTO SPS agreements. In terms of SADC, there has been a move trying to get to looking more at SPS in terms of regional risk assessments and that type of stuff. It's not very successful. You get a lot of countries are actually kicking in their heels, not wanting to move on SPS. A lot of the countries in Africa is not even publicizing the SPS requirements. So you do have that difficulty as well. And then also with SPS, unfortunately, in Africa, there's quite a lot of lack of trust among the countries where your product gets tested either in South Africa or in the EU. Even if you do have a laboratory, you do have the capacity, the countries do not trust your documentation. So they still require that you need to send it to an independent lab to be verified. I'm not sure to what extent the CFTA will actually look at SPS. Are we just going to go back to WTO, saying look at the WTO agreements, or will we actually try and really look at what is necessary within the region?
Thank you for your question. It's an interesting question. I think it goes directly to which law is superior between the EAC treaty itself and its associated protocols and then some of the laws that are being formulated governing individual areas. Certainly the EAC treaty provides for, it provides for the ultimate jurisdiction being the Court of Justice. So to the extent that the non-tariff barriers are covered in the EAC treaty, you would actually take a case to the Court of Justice. But there's also a panel process within the EAC which is not being utilized, which could be faster than actually a long court process within the EAC. Thank you.
Thank you very much, William. And it's time to wrap up. Unfortunately, we can't answer all of the questions at this stage. I would like just to emphasize the importance of the political economy of this process. This is absolutely critical. And for us to understand the domestic political economy processes in all member states, this is going to be extremely important. Political will at head of state level is perhaps easy to achieve, but what happens after that is going to be extremely important. And this is where we will see the articulation of particular interests, as they should be by member states in negotiating the CFTA. We're hoping that common sense will prevail, that issues such as those raised in connection about the beneficiaries, the youth, our future of the continent will be taken into account, and that non-state actors will be able to participate. There are some interesting provisions related to observer status in the process, which give us hope that non-state actors, organizations, will be able to get a window into what is happening in the process. So thank you very much. We look forward to engaging with you. Please contact us. We'd be happy to discuss further with you. Thank you so much for your participation.